That is the little keyboard game.
Oh, that's what it is. It's a
keyboard
like that.
Oh, okay.
Certain questions as a bisexual activist, you just get to ask. You know, like that. Thank you. It's as simple as that, right? So, that's me on the Obama White House website. It's so funny, it's now obamawhitehouse.gov, .com or something. But, you know, this is some information you just heard, actually. That's a photo of me 9 months pregnant, actually. And some of the things that I write about, right? We kind of already covered this a little bit, but I definitely want to talk about how I survived, thrive past bullying, child abuse, sexual assault, rape, suicidality, racism, sexism, poverty, and of course my favorite being a smart ass. Doesn't have to survive something, right? So this is the fun part for you guys too. Since we have such a big group, maybe people can just call it out from here or there. And the cool thing is I brought some chocolate.
Yeah.
So if you answer, you can just come up and help yourself. Because obviously chocolate is a good way to start things. It's not just because I'm black. It's also because I'm black. All right, so we've got dark chocolate with blueberry here. Anybody's interested? You interested? I just love both your hair and your, just your beautiful smile. Okay, so we also have some, anybody like peanut M&Ms?
Yes.
All right, shout your name out if you like peanut M&Ms.
Right!
All right, come on up and get some. Really, seriously, come on up. Honestly, why not?
Yes, they're on the board.
Okay, great. Cool. And then we're going to talk about the bisexual community. Anybody here identify as bisexual? Pansexual? Fluid? Queer? Polysexual? Omnisexual? Non-monosexual? All-sexual? Trisexual? Demisexual? I'm just going to go down the right list. Right? Of things that you can identify these days. So I always like to make sure we ask that question. We're also going to talk a little bit of colonization that introduced prudence, right, of homosexualities or gender identities of variants, right, but rather a system of surveillance, right, rather a system of tracking, right, and within a generation, there was an ability for folks to kind of say, you know what, let's not talk about it, let's put it someplace else, and, you know, let's also maybe even forget about it and stigmatize it. So we see that it varies, though, over the entire continent, right? A lot of folks, you know, when we look at the history of Africa, or even the history of, you know, I mean, it's a huge history, right? It's a huge continent, right? It's a much bigger than most of the things that are out there, right? So you're going to see 500 different ways for people to describe same-sex attraction across hundreds of languages, right? But most of those words actually refer to sexual acts. Right? So we actually see people saying, hey, he's like a guy who, you know, he wants to marry this other guy, but he's going to stay at home, the other guy's going to go out, right? Or he's only going to be sexually in this relationship with this man for a short period of time, right? But we do see folks like Queen Azinga, right, or other folks who are really high up, even going so far as to negotiate with the Dutch, 1500s. Right, at the same time that they are actually women, female identified, ruling as men with wives. Right? So you have some really amazing history as far as what the variance looks like. We see that across African diaspora, right, that term that we use to describe the spread kind of blackness, whether voluntary or involuntary. Obviously, you saw Mr. Carson had to apologize about his stumble there recently. For most people, there's an understanding that that process, right, of forced migration, of slavery, right, at the same time is mirroring a story that people are bringing with them, right? Sometimes that story is also about embodying other genders. Sometimes that story is about religiously experiencing something in a way that allows you to be a god or a goddess, right? And so we see that a little bit more in Creole backgrounds, and West Indian backgrounds, what I identify with myself. Other places that I think are really important for folks to think about when we look at the experience of Black LGBT folks, the history of support in Black communities with LGBT experience, right? So this is a really important letter from Huey Newton. Anybody know who Huey Newton is? Here we go. So Huey Newton's writing a letter in 1970, right, in support of the Gay Liberation Front, also in support of women's liberation. Right, one of the things I just love most here, and I actually, when I first started doing this presentation, I used to call it the most revolutionary, right, because I thought it was so telling, right, that Newton was able to identify that he wasn't able to be 100% comfortable, right? He's saying in the letter, hey, I get it. Maybe you're not going to get it right away, right? But maybe that's the process of being a revolutionary, right? It's accepting certain things outside of your own view, right? So he says, maybe I'm now injecting some of my prejudice, right? And that's such a great idea, right? For people to really recognize even someone who is as radical a thinker, right, as a co-founder of the Black Panther Party, is really, really, that's being, maybe that's part of what radical thinking is. To constantly be thinking about where you're missing, right? What more you can do. And so, quite contrary, maybe a homosexual would be the most revolutionary. Right? It's often forgotten that there's those roots. Now we see those roots kind of brought back, right, with the history and the development of the Black Lives Matter network, which is centered here in trans liberation as well, right? So we start to see that there is some ties going through our history here. So Audrey and June, which this photo is a little bit, but you can actually see this photo at the Black History Museum in DC if you get a chance to go there. I thought that was great that they included that photo of June Jordan, Alice Walker, and Lucille Clifton and Audre Lorde together at Phyllis Wheatley Poetry Festival, right? But we had this really amazing moment, again, with Black lesbian, Black bisexual woman. Anybody heard of Audre Lorde? gays being a pop player. I don't know. But we're going to play a game right now called Intersectional Electric. And so I'm going to need everybody who can come down to the front to come down. I know. It's weird. Somebody's like, you can get up. You walked in here and sat down. You can get up again, right? We're going to come over here. We're going to play a game that talks about our intersections. Right? Anybody who wishes to, anybody who doesn't, you know, no judgment. Let me right here. We're going to play a game.
Come on. Come on. But if you're not single, it's okay too. Alright, but I think it's really great because I think a lot of times we don't always think about what we're missing in the room too. So I'm going to start off with the obvious, which is my obvious, which is black. Because I'm black. Anybody here who's white? Anybody? White folks? Alright. Jewish. to draw if you have other intersections around here, say you're biracial, multiracial.
If you finish, you can sit down, though.
Hey,
if you finish, you can sit down, just so.
Yeah.
They're just going to keep going.
I was like, yeah, I sit down. Every right? It's not confusing to her at all, right? So, you know, it's one of these things that we really want folks to know, and I think it's really important to actually say as well, don't assume anything about sexuality, including your own, right? You just don't know what could happen. So, the by definition that we see really used a lot is Robin Oakes' definition. Bisexuals are people who acknowledge themselves the potential to be attracted romantically and or sexually to people of more than one sex and or gender, not necessarily at the same time, not necessarily the same way, and not necessarily to the same degree, right? So what are the three things again? Might be on a test, right? Not necessarily the same time, same way, or the same degree, right? So basically, you could be bisexual if you were like Freddie Mercury. Right, in a recent book about him, he's the lead singer of a band called Queen. Okay, you've heard of them. So, you know, he says to his girl, Mary Austin, Mary, I'm bisexual. She goes, Freddie, you're gay. Mary, I'm bisexual. He replies again, Freddie, you're gay. And that's in the book as a proof that Freddie Mercury is gay. Hmm. Right? Now, what did Freddie Mercury end up doing when he dies? He leaves his entire estate to his wife, Mary Austin. He leaves every dollar. He leaves his ashes. Right? That would be what we could look at as romantic attraction. Right? Did he get down with some dudes? Probably. So, we see bisexuality is not as easily described as this duality. Somebody who's super, super all about that, Frank Ocean, right? Someone who really sparked a lot of conversations about labels when he came out, right? People were like, well, what is he? Right, and that, again, that refusal to embrace that box is part of the bisexual experience, right? You can also call it part of the fluid experience. You can also call it part of the pansexual experience, right? It would be probably pretty important to identify that labels for bi plus people, as we use that term to refer to a larger community of us, change over time, right? When I was starting doing LGBT activism in 98, and I had my first girlfriend, I was a lesbian. And then I thought I was in love with Keanu Reeves after I saw The Matrix, and I became queer. And then I fell in love with a trans girl and became pansexual. And then I stayed in love with a trans girl, became pansexual and queer. And then I became bisexual, right? And then I identified as pansexual and queer again, right? And then I was all these things at the same time, right? And then people will ask me, what are you today? And they say, you know, maybe I don't want to talk about it anymore. So you see the bisexual celebrity say that in the press. Maybe think about how many labels they've gone through. How many conversations have they had? Maybe they don't want to talk about it anymore, right? But it is something that we talk about as a community exercise, right? Because you have that fluidity, because you have that capacity, right? Your labels are going to change based off what's going on, right? Based off of who you are, right? But that conversation shouldn't be used as an attack on either community, right? A person who's pansexual, right? If you happen to go to Pansexual Pride on Facebook, the largest pansexual group, like 1,250,000 people in this Facebook group, they kind of look different than the folks that are in the bisexual group, right? We do see some differences, right? Namely, that many times people who identify as pan also identify with other genders, right? Their experience of gender can be different than a person who's bisexual who say, it's not that I don't like gender, I just don't care, right? So if they have a male partner, a female partner, a no gender partner, honestly, they're just looking for love or something else. But, you know, when we see that population in the U.S., what do we actually know about them? We're starting to know some pretty interesting stuff. Namely, it's a huge population. 40 to 60% of the entire lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender community identify as bi, right? So we talk about that real big need for people to understand that and also be able to identify that trans folks are people who have a different gender identity than cisgender, also can be bisexual, also can be pan. We know as well that coming out experience for bi people who probably saw a recent case of that in the news with Amber Heard and her former partner, Johnny Depp, right? But Amber Heard definitely has a story that's very, very similar to other bisexual women who report that their partners express jealousy over their capacity, right? Interestingly enough, there was one story with, there was a video of Johnny Depp, and he wasn't upset at her wanting to date women, right? He was like, oh, you're gonna leave me for all these other guys. You know, and I was like, ah, curse worked the other way there. So it's like a bad Pirates of the Caribbean movie. But you know, it's one of these things where it's not, you don't know how it can arise. You don't know what particular stressors can happen in a relationship, but we do know that biphobia can lead to really high rates of abuse of bisexual women, and that those women will then continue to be abused, right, for most of their life cycle, which is something that we are obviously very concerned about within the bi community. We also see that really high number also for rape, right? Rape for bisexual women, 46% of bi women reported to the CDC that they had experienced rape in their lifetime. And that mirrors the numbers that we see for trans communities as well, meaning that folks who are bi and trans can have really high astronomical rates of violence. So other priorities that we kind of see, you know, continue to look at what sexual violence can happen, other things that are huge for our community, suicidality, right? Thinking about suicide, thinking about not wanting to be here, something that's really high for bi communities. A couple of years ago, we actually had a run of folks who just couldn't make it. We started a program called Make It to Tomorrow. We have all these things that will happen on Twitter or Facebook, something this week or last week was BiQuiff, which was just a bunch of people on Twitter just being like, I just need to talk, I need to have some support, right? And partially what we see is that that support for more people who are feeling suicidal or otherwise isn't necessarily always there at the LGBT Center or other places. So, speaking of which, we talked about some of that data that's not so fun. Let's play one last game, right? Talk about some of that, kind of those feelings that aren't so fun, maybe some feelings that aren't sort of kind of fun. So what we're going to do is we're going to have this room split up into four corners. One corner is going to be hell no, right? Like, say I asked you, anybody, you know, I don't know, what's a question you guys would answer hell no to? Like, anybody signed up to go to finals early? Okay, I don't know, somebody answer hell no to that. I feel like you could say no to that, right? That would be a no. Other things that somebody might say hell no to, having unsafe sex, you know, whatever their version of safe is, right? Whether that's discussing with their partner. Other things that people might say hell yes to, right, when we go through this exercise, you know, we're going to ask some questions, you know, like, would you date anybody in this group? You know, if there was consent on both sides. Somebody might say yeah, right? I don't know. You look like you might say yeah. You might have glasses. I don't know. Maybe you're already dating somebody in this room. All right. So maybe no, it wasn't me, right? Maybe we could talk about certain things. You could say, no, that wasn't me, but it definitely was somebody, like a friend of mine, right? Like, if I say, hey, do you know somebody who's experienced sexual violence and who's able to go get help from the center here or talk to somebody here, right? What are those processes like? If you have an opportunity to share your resources or share other things that you've seen work for people on this campus, it's a great opportunity to bring it up too, right? But we'll also ask questions of each other in like, you know, 5 to 7 minutes will be a lot for this exercise. Mm-hmm. All right, so everybody up. Let's hear the question. How do you feel about Marvel? Right? I have issues marked sometimes because of their racial problems. Most days I like them. So, you know, I would probably end up in the no, it wasn't me, just because of the whole Iron Fist situation. But, you know, let's just split up. Everybody go. If you like Marvel, end up with a yes. If you don't like Marvel because they suck, if you're a DC fan, you're a no. If you have no opinion, you're in. I don't care. Decline to answer. Who gives a crap about comics? Folks think you're dumb.
Quiet, please.
All right, so we've got just one or two question time for any questions. Any anybody got any questions about what we covered today? How was meeting Obama? It's always the best to talk about, right? So I met the president for the first time in 2010. I was invited to the LGBT Pride reception, and I was like, oh my god, I have to see him. So I stood in line, like, there's this room he's in. They're like, you can just stand here. So I waited there for 2 hours while all these other people were like eating, like drinking, having fun. Me, I'm like. So then, you know, everybody comes in and he enters the room, but because they announced him, everyone's the president of the United States. Everybody turned to the announcer, which actually might have been racism, but like, and he just walked in and it was just me and him. And he's like, hey, it's the president. And I'm like, dude, you are so the president. And I don't know why I said that, but I just was like, dude. I can't believe either. Like, you know, it feels weird for both of us. He was like, you're hilarious, I like you. I was like, oh. So that was 2010. And then after that, I spent countless hours. I've probably been to the White House 75 times. I went 4 or 5 times a week if I could. Like, everything, I actually almost got into everything I wanted to get into, except for when Prime Minister Trudeau came. That was a hot ticket. But besides that, I just tried to always represent the BI community, and that was great. And then in 2014, I had the opportunity to witness him to the signing, which was really amazing to be in the room with him, to talk to him. He thought I was hilarious. Yeah, which is great. And then this last year, I had the great honor to take my kids to the holiday party. So my kid was on my husband's shoulders, and the president came out. I say, are you Obama? The president had to stop his speech and say, yes. Yes, I am. Give him, like, you know, the old child, be quiet, Sarah, which my kid totally shut up at that point. I'm only a little bit mortified. So, I'd say he's one of the nicest, great people. I've had a great opportunity to work with him. I also work for Sarah Ferguson, the Duchess of York. So I was had an opportunity to help launch the Queen of England's YouTube channel. And if I had a chance to choose between two families, it would be very hard for me. Both of them are extremely nice and very, just say, people who chose to do better with the cards that they were dealt than they could have, I think. So.
Thank you so much. We're out of time.
Thank you so much.